Okay, in the position that you can see at the diagram again, black to move. Again, white seems to be better because of his better pawn structure. Black has isolated pawn on d5. His pawns on the queen side are also weak, and the white queen right now attacks the pawn on a7. White seems to have more active pieces. His queen on a4 seems to be active than his black counterpart on f5, attacking the rook and the pawn on a7. The knight on f4 is pretty well placed to attack the pawn on d5. The white rook occupies the open file and can go to the 7th rank very soon to attack the a7 and f7 pawns. So black seems to be worse in this position, and if he plays something like rook e7 at this point to protect the pawn on a7, white has a pleasant choice. One possibility for him is to play knight takes on d5. This move is possible because of the back rank weakness. Black cannot take back with the queen due to rook c8, and white just checkmates on the back rank. Otherwise, if knight takes on d5, white has a fork, e4, and now again, black should control the c8 square. Black cannot move the queen out of the h3 c8 diagonal. Probably the best bet for him is queen g4. It allows him to exchange the queens, and after e takes on d5, queen takes on a4, b takes on a4. Black should fight for a draw in this endgame, being a pawn down. If white does not want to simplify the position, rook and games pretty often are drawish. White can just keep playing the middle game. Queen c6 can be a good alternative to knight takes on d5. And again, white can exchange the queens playing queen c8. White can use the queen to attack the pawns on the queen side. Queen a8 can be unpleasant for black at some point. So again, white seems to be better. White seems to be more active in this position. And again, if at this point black thinks not only about defense but also about counterattack, he can identify a target for his attack, and this target is on the king side. Indeed, white has some holes on the king side around his king. I mean f3, h3 squares. These squares are not so well protected by the white pieces, and if black can somehow bring, let's say, his knight to the f3 square, it can definitely help him to increase the pressure on the white king. But right now it's difficult to imagine what should black do to bring the knight to this f3 square. Right now the knight is bound to protect the rook on e8. Black cannot just play knight g4. White just takes the rook, and the game will be over for black. And even if he moves the rook and then plays knight g4, knight e5, it seems to be slow, and definitely white is just faster attacking black pawns on the queen side. So to make his counterattack more efficient, black needs to make use of his pawns. And again, black should do it on the king side of the board. And the first idea that could come to your mind is to play g5. But if you play g5 right now, it does not really help you, but rather weakens your position. After h takes on g5, queen takes on g5, the knight on f4 is very stable. And without driving this knight away, black cannot do anything. White can play something like rook c6. It creates a threat of rook takes on f6, followed by queen takes on e8. And again, white seems to be much better, and I would say black just worsens his position playing g5 and weakening his king side. But instead of immediate g5, black can make one preparatory move, h6, and it seriously improves his chances to attack on the king side. The idea to play h6 is obvious. Black wants to play g5, but in the case of h takes on g5, he wants to take back with the pawn. In doing so, he can attack the knight, and after the white knight leaves, black can play knight e4, knight g4 with the tempo, attacking the pawn on f2, so it allows him to win time and develop his counterplay faster. At this point, probably the best bet for white is rook c7, to bring the rook to the 7th rank. If white first takes the pawn on a7, he can be punished. Black can play g5, and let's say after knight g2, knight e4, it's easy to notice that the white queen is out of play. It cannot support the white king, and black develops very strong attack on the king side. For instance, if white plays rook f1 to protect the pawn on f2, knight d2 seems to be very unpleasant. The knight attacks the rook, and what is more dangerous, black is going to bring the knight to f3, then queen goes to h3. In doing so, black can arrange a checkmate pattern. Or if white plays rook c2 in this position, black can consider some discovered attack. For instance, knight takes on g3, alternatively queen f3. Queen f3 can be even better. Queen is heading to the first rank, queen d1, and again, the white queen is just too far away, and black, I would say, winning in this position already. So let's try rook c7. Rook c7, again, black plays g5 at this point. If knight retreats, let's say, to g2, it is just bad, because now black can play queen b1 check, king h2, rook e4, taking the queen, followed by knight g4, and queen h1 again. It looks like black is winning, arranging another checkmate pattern. If knight retreats to e2, in this case, black cannot play knight e4, knight g4 immediately because of the rook on e8. But he can move it to f8. I would say it is the best position for the rook to protect the pawn on f7. And white cannot do anything to attack this rook. So next move, black plays either knight e4, knight g4, queen b1 is still possible. So definitely black got some counterplay, and he has good chances to resist in this position, even if white is still better. Okay, after black played g5, probably the best chance for white is to play h takes on g5, h takes on g5, and knight h5. Again, this move is possible because of the rook on e8. Black cannot take the knight because of queen takes on e8. But after black plays rook e6, again, black seems to be pretty active in this position. Now his rook can be used to attack the pawn on f2. In the case of knight takes on f6, black uses the rook to take back. And again, black got counterplay, so in this position he has good chances to survive, and I'm not sure that white is still better at this point. Okay, let's switch to another example. Next position that you can see at the diagram occurred in a recent Grandmasters game played at the Aeroflot Open 2018. On the white side is Alexey Aleksandrov, a member of the national team of Belarus. On the black side is Aleksandra Goryachkina, talented female player from Russia who has recently won the Russian Women Chess Championship. So, in this position, black to move. As you can see, the knight on g6 is protected only by the pawn on f7. White has two pieces to attack it, the bishop on d3 as well as the queen on c2. So white is threatening to play bishop takes on g6. And at this point, Aleksandra Goryachkina, playing black, did a very brave decision. She played b takes on c4. She did not move the knight back, no knight f8. She preferred to start her counterplay on the queen side. White should play b takes on c4 first, and another capture, d takes on c4. So this move allows white to play bishop takes on g6. After bishop takes on g6, followed by queen takes on g6, black loses the right to castle, but again, it was the best bet to play this position. Black was slightly passive in the initial position, white has a bishop pair, so black's best chance is to open up the files on the queen side in a hope to attack the white king. Aleksandrov played bishop takes on g6. This move seems to be very natural. It's very difficult actually to deviate from this move, but instead of bishop takes on g6, alternatively, white could play bishop takes on c4, and as for me, it was the best bet for white in this position. Indeed, the knight on g6 is pretty bad piece. It does not attack anything. The knight is limited by the pawn on g3, by the pawn on d4, and so cannot jump anywhere. Whereas for white, it's very important to keep his bishop pair if white plans to advance his pawns in the center. One possibility for white in this position can be e4 followed by d5 to open up the center and to attack the black king that is still in the center. Also, white's bishops can be helpful to oppose the black's threats on the queen side and can help white to cover the king. So in the game, white played bishop takes on g6, f takes on g6, and queen takes on g6. I'm not sure that it was the best bet in the position. The pawns on the g file are bad, and instead of playing queen takes on g6, white could consider to play knight a4. The idea behind this move, first of all, white wants to play knight b6, and doing so, white can attack the black queen on d7 and the black rook on a8, so he can win the exchange. And again, at this point, black is not obligated to guard the b6 square immediately. He has an interesting resource of c3. The idea behind this move, if knight takes on c3, there is no knight b6 anymore, so black can choose between king f7, protecting the pawn on g6, or alternatively, black can castle. Black can easily give up the pawn on g6, so black's main goal in this position to bring his heavy pieces, to bring his rooks, to bring his queen as soon as possible to the queen side, to attack the white king. The position seems to be unclear. I would say black has good compensation for the pawn. Bishop cannot take on c3 because of bishop takes on a3. Otherwise, if white uses the queen to take the pawn, black can play rook b8 to take control over the b6 square. Then again, he can castle, and because of the b-file that black got at the disposal, because of the ideas with knight d5, knight e4, queen d5, black seems to have pretty good counterplay on the queen side, and I believe this counterplay should compensate a lot of his pawn weaknesses around the board. Okay, let's see what happened in the game. In the game, Aleksandrov took the pawn on g6 immediately. Black played king f8. Indeed, it is the best square for the king. And at this point, Aleksandrov did a serious mistake. He took another pawn. He is too avid for pawns. Queen takes on g5. It was completely meaningless pawn. And again, it was better for white to play knight a4 in this position with the same idea of knight b6. But after he played queen takes on g5, the pawn was poisoned. And the thing is that black got a chance to bring his corner rook to the queen side very fast. Black did a rook lift. Probably Aleksandrov missed the thing. Rook h5. And after queen g6, rook a5. Look at the black rook now. It looks much more active than before. It can attack the pawn on a3, and now the white king is in a big danger. White does not have enough resources to protect his queen side, and again, black increases his pressure very quickly. So let's see. White played queen c2. The queen goes back to support the bishop, to support the king. Black played rook b8, very natural move. Rook occupies the open file. And Aleksandrov played king d2 at this point. His king starts running for a life. If king keeps staying on the c file, Goryachkina played rook b3. Again, this move seems to be very natural. The rook is very well supported by the pawn on c4. If the white knight moves the rook and go to d3 square, also the rook helps to attack the pawn on e3. But if black plays c5, if black